just to start out, I just want to let you guys know that this is going to be, again, fun, interactive. I would love it if your environments allow for you to show your faces. I love seeing reactions. I love being able to answer questions. And I would love for us to be able to connect that way. If you can't, that's cool. If you have any questions, I am going to ask that you hold it off for about 15 minutes or so. I'm not going to do a full sort of presentation. I'm going to kind of do a condensed version and then jump right into Q&A and any questions that you have. This is a real passion of mine, digital storytelling, and I am really excited about kind of sharing with you a fundamental approach. I think that stories are critical for not just people that are like me that create content, but critical for individuals at large. If you own a business, if you are in school, if you are a professional, if you're a presenter, if you are a writer, if you are, a note taker, you should master and understand the art and the skill of telling stories. So, and leveraging stories to connect to your demo or your demographic, I should say. So I'm going to actually switch screens. Allow me to be enabled for screen sharing and then we can get going. So this presentation is called Digital Storytelling for Everyone. Digital Storytelling for Everyone. Like I said before, I'm Tristan Barrocks. I go by the Digital Storyteller and I'm really, really excited to be a part of this amazing group. So just an overview really quickly of some of the things we're going to touch on. We're going to touch on what digital storytelling is, what makes a good story, right? Because it doesn't make sense that we understand the importance of digital storytelling and what that is, but not understand the elements of building a good story. And if you can oblige me with regards to some of the things that we're going to be talking about, because really it's all going to circle back around to how this can be used in your actual day-to-day life, your profession. What digital storytelling is not, right? It's great that we know what it is. It's great. We know the fundamental tools of how to kind of use stories in our day-to-day lives, but we also need to identify what it's not in order to become better at it, right? And then lastly, it'll just be Q&A, okay? So a lot of people walk in and they think digital storytelling, like what is that? I'm not a digital storyteller, right? But one of the things I want to kind of hit home right away is that stories are all around us. Stories are all around us. They're not these sort of mythical things out there that only Spielberg and Ryan Coogler and all these other great directors do and put together. Stories are what we use to communicate with people and connect with our audiences. And they're all around us. And we can use them and leverage them in so many different ways. And the thing is, your story is your perspective, right? One of the things that I live by and I encourage others to live by in terms of a principle is that, one of the greatest gifts that we have to our communities and to our world is our perspectives. And our perspectives are shaped by our stories and shaped by our experiences. And the method by which we kind of share our stories, share our perspectives and gain other types of perspectives is by using storytelling, is by watching a movie, watching a documentary, hearing somebody's story, reading somebody's book. Quick plug, shameless plug. I know Deputy Mayor Steve Anderson came out with his book, and I believe it was his autobiography or his biography about his life. And that was really, really cool. But like, there's so many different methods and ways that you can use your story to share your unique perspective, right? And that's something that we need to be comfortable with and we need to own. And it's not something that we need to run away from, but it's actually something we can use to really gain a level of value.
Started ballet when I was 2.5, because I remember saying, like, I'm 2.5, not 2. One of my first classes, like, very basic little ballet, and the teacher had us like point our toes to the front like we were performing on stage. And I had this image of like these sparkly red shoes on my feet, and they said perform with them, make them like emphasize them basically. And then since then I fell in love with performing, and red, it's my favorite color now. So I was into the more like puzzles, math, sciences, so like a lot of things there.
So I'm going to keep on going because I want you to go ahead and watch that a little bit later. I know I kind of drew you in with that little story, and I know you probably want to see more, but I want to give time for questions and things of that nature. But that young lady, is an amazing young lady. Her name's Jasmine, and she's a dancer. Her and her story and her mom, actually, I connected with them last year, and I had this idea where I just want to kind of show diversity within sort of the dance and ballet spectrum and world. And I just put out a call. I connected with them, and we told her story. Now, you'd think, okay, well, what does that have to do with this? But I want to show you that to show you that you know, there were opportunities that actually came out of me sharing her story, and the opportunities were of documentaries, of brand films, of other things like that. But it came out of me having a passion to tell somebody else's story. But it could have easily been my story. It could have been my story about the way I was raised, or, you know, why I love storytelling, or why I love, you know, Shelburne. One of the films that got a lot of, I guess it got a lot of views and a lot of interactivity was one of the first videos I did when I was up here, was the one with Streams. The whole idea of, and for those of you that don't know what Streams is, it's called Streams Community Hub. It's it was started by some friends of mine, Andrew and Julianne James. They're a couple that live just across the street from me. And with that film was just supposed to kind of tell the story of why they moved up here, why they started Streams, what Streams is all about. And from that led into so many other opportunities, because for them and for myself, because we were, again, leveraging stories and storytelling. So what is digital storytelling? Well, for me, in my opinion, what digital storytelling is, it is the intentional crafting of human-centered stories, themes, using digital platforms. So it's basically, you know, telling human-centered stories using things like digital video, graphic design, digital photography, anything that has to utilizes or leverages digital tools, by also crafting stories within them. So that's sort of what digital storytelling is. Again, this is my own personal definition. You may get other definitions, but again, anytime you pick up your phone, whether it's, you know, going on to Instagram and using Instagram stories, or, you know, going on to LinkedIn or doing a Facebook Live, all of those are different ways of leveraging digital storytelling to connect with your audience. So what makes a good story? What are some of the things? If you don't mind typing in the chat, some of the elements, or if you want to, you can jump in and you can quickly just say, hey, you know, raise your hand. You could suggest some good elements that make up a great story. I'll give everybody a moment to kind of think about that. Think about what makes a good story. What are some of the things that make a good story?
Yeah. So I can read out some of the comments. One is, an amazing story is something personal and then a happy ending. That was from Bella.
Okay.
Jade, something that is relatable. One that evokes emotions.
Okay.
A good lead in. That's from Josh.
Awesome. Yeah. So these are some ingredients to telling a good story. So this is the list that I'm going to share with you right now are things that I've kind of used as more fundamental things, but you can add to the list and you can subtract the things that don't really matter to you or you don't feel work for you. But all of those suggestions are great suggestions. Thank you so much for sharing those. So the first thing is, it needs to be universal, right? This is something that is tried and true, right? Universal themes like good and evil, or, you know, the underdog, or, you know, breaking through barriers, or, you know, trying to build bridges and not walls. All of those sort of universal themes make great stories, right? There's a reason why we like Rocky, and there's been now 10 or 15 Rocky movies that are essentially the same thing. We all know that they're going to end up in a boxing ring, right? We all know that, but we're still going to sit down and watch and watch Michael B. Jordan or watch Stallone, you know, in several different movies, telling the story of the underdog or telling the story of a fighter, a person that's going to persevere no matter what against the odds, right? So always think about how you can leverage universal themes in your story. It should come from an honest place. Honesty and authenticity is something that I find is undervalued right now. And I think that the more that I create stories, tell stories, and I work with other brands, one of the main goals that most brands want to get to is a place of authenticity, or where things at least feel authentic. Because when people are faking it a little bit, we can all kind of tell when people aren't really giving us their whole self, or giving us a portion of themselves, or giving us a thin veneer of what they want us to like about them, right? And there's something to be said about, you know, the reason why people like Oprah, or people like, I don't know, you can name some of the authentic people that we follow. I mean, you know, there's some presidents that were really, really just out there and spoke a lot, and people liked that authenticity or that sense of authenticity. So again, when we're thinking about telling our stories, we want to think about it from a place of honesty and authenticity, like true honesty and authenticity, and not trying to fake it, but using elements from our story in order to share it with the public. Now, again, the other question that sometimes comes up is, you know, am I supposed to tell my whole story, like my whole story, like everything, my business? No, you don't have to tell your whole business, okay? It's really about being able to share some of those broad strokes. So whether it was, you know, for me, I usually, when I tell my story, I talk about the fact that, you know, 6 years ago, I just moved up to a new community into Shelburne, and right there and then I lost my job, like within 2 months of closing my house and buying a new car. And we, you know, my wife just came off of mat leave. She decided not to go back to work. We looked at each other and we were like, okay, what are we going to do? Right. People can relate to that. That's coming from an honest place. And that sparked my journey into kind of doing digital storytelling full time on my own, in my own business. Right. But all of those different elements can be used as ways to kind of hook in and draw in the actual listener or the viewer. Be funny or interesting, right? A lot of great stories have funny parts to them, have funny elements to them, right? Have interesting elements that aren't prototypical, right? You know, whether it's watching a movie and it's a romantic comedy and the boy and the girl don't end up together, but they end up, you know, doing something else. And maybe the ending is non-traditional. That's interesting. That's something different. What are some interesting things that you can pull from your own personal journey or your brand journey, right? Whether you're working for a brand or a corporation, or you're building your own brand and you're building your own business. What are some of the funny moments or the interesting moments that you can jot down, even right now or later on when you think about it, that you can incorporate into your story? It appeals to our deepest emotions, right? Any stories that actually are good stories are ones that really bring us in. I was watching a documentary the other day. It was about the post-secondary school scandal where well-to-do parents were paying for their kids to get into affluent schools and things of that nature. And it really got me upset. It got me upset because they were telling the story of these affluent families. And, you know, I was thinking about, you know, when I was applying to school and how hard it was and how difficult it was, and just seeing how there were these loopholes in the system, and the way the documentarian kind of broke down the whole story, it pulled at my emotional strings, right? It made me feel a little bit of a way, because I was like, man, like, these guys are getting away with so much stuff. That's a great storytelling. But there's the other way of going about it is watching stories that maybe uplift us, right? Selma by Ava DuVernay is a great story. I go on Instagram and TikTok and I see people telling stories all the time that are uplifting me. And they're not, you know, multi-million dollar films. They're just well-told stories that pull at my emotions because maybe I relate to it, or maybe I'm gaining a new perspective on a story that I never heard before. And they should be simple and focused, okay? So when we're talking about simple and focused, we, again, we don't want your whole story. We don't want mama and cousin and auntie and Tootsie. We just need just streamlined, clean storytelling, whether it's, you know, the reason why I started this brand was to solve a problem. The problem was that, you know, people can't cut their grass in our community. And I believe in cutting grass and having great manicured lawns. So I decided to create this business. And that could be a streamlined, straightforward story. You can make it interesting. You can make it funny. You can make it charismatic. You can pluck at our heartstrings. Maybe it's like, and I'm fundraising because, you know, all of the funds that I raise is going to go to this cancer society in memory of my late aunt or whatever it is. But you can make stories really interesting, but they have to be simple and they have to be focused. We have to be able to follow them. How are we doing out there? Everybody good? Just want to make sure. Just checking in. Okay. Good. Because I'll wake you up. I'm ready. Okay.
Let's check out some. Thank you.
Growing up, I always thought my father was Superman. I mean, he was the funniest guy in the room. He was the strongest dude. He was the smartest man I ever knew. He was the most loving and caring person I ever knew. He was definitely the best cook. Sorry, Mom, you're the best baker. And I always just looked at him like he was just a superhero. He could do no wrong other than when he was disciplining me. In my eyes, he was just, he's perfect.
I love how everybody knows what street that is. That's Cook Street, right? Yes, it is. Big up Cook Street. Yeah, so this video, I'll talk to you guys about this after. I am going to jump to the next one. Just to give you another example of storytelling.
Bossy, Godfather, man a OG, man a half humble, man a bossy. Fling a rag a rhythm like it's all free. Bossy, house on the coast, G. My money so long it doesn't know me. It's looking at my kids like I'm bossy.
Bang bang bang, hey hey. So when me spitty body ready, maybe gal I get with it. Spitty body ready, maybe gal I get. When me trippy body ready, maybe gal I get with it. Wind up your body and spin it, girl. When you bubble.
All right, so those two are obviously two extremely different types of storytelling methods. One, again, was one continuous shot of me running wildly down the street while my son is running in his pajamas, and that was a Father's Day tribute. And the story behind that, really quickly, is I wanted to do this big sort of Father's Day film because I'm really big on a big advocate for celebrating fathers on Father's Day, just like we do with any other sort of holiday. And I want to interview a whole bunch of fathers. Didn't get to do that. It was like the night before Father's Day, and I was like, okay, I don't know if I'm going to be able to do anything. Okay, I got to do something. Told Zefton, my son, to run outside, just go in his Superman pajamas, run outside. Daddy's got your back. I'm going to watch out for cars. We're going to film this thing. I had no idea what I was going to do. The next day, I slept on it. Next day, I woke up and it was Father's Day. And I was like, okay, let me just record something, my thoughts about my father. And then I just kind of put this whole film together. Now, that was just a trailer that you saw, but that, and I didn't feel really proud of it. Like, I was like, man, this is all I could do. And, you know, it's kind of patchwork, but I just need to do something for Father's Day. This is almost a therapeutic exercise at this point. And that was one of the most, you know, I guess popular films and videos to this day that I've ever created, because it came from a really authentic and true place. And it spoke to people from an emotional level. Like, people that were fathers or that had great fathers looked to that film and said, wow, like, I relate to that. Like, that's, yeah, like, I love my dad like that. I appreciate my dad. And then the other one was just more of like, sometimes, you know, you go into a long weekend or you had a long weekend, you just want to like turn up a little bit. You just want to have some fun. And people can see that side of you. It's okay to show that side of you. There's nothing wrong with that. So again, just showing the different sides of being able to be comical and delightful and entertaining. And the other side of things, we can be emotional and really poignant and focused in that direction. So what digital storytelling is not. I always like using this photo because this is this photo is me running away from people that I just don't want to talk to because they just don't understand storytelling, or they tell too long of stories and they try and include everything in their story and I just want to run away from it. So when I look at this picture, I think of that and I think of the fact of these are the elements of storytelling I really, really don't want to include in my stories because it really has nothing to do with digital storytelling. And plus it's a funny picture in general. So storytelling is not about the tech. This is something that's really, really important. Many of us think that, I need to have the iPhone 18 and I need to have, the $5,000, whatever Sony camera. And I need to have $10,000 this and whatever else and lights and cameras. No, you don't have to have all this technology in order to tell and convey meaningful stories. All you really need is you just need to have a level of intentionality, the phone that you own already or the computer that you own already, and you're good to go and you can create stories. You can create digital stories. It's not about the expensive technology or the gear that you have. It's about your desire to tell the story. It's not about influence. Many people think that, well, if I include this person and this politician and this popular person and this influencer and this person co-signs it, then now it's going to be a really good digital storytelling. Or digital story, my apologies. It actually doesn't work that way at all. I've seen many stories, digital stories and just normal plays and movies and whatever else that were terrible, that had A-list celebrities, that had people co-sign it, and they were still terrible because the fundamental thing was true, which was story was not first. If story is not first and is not center in whatever you're creating and whatever you're using, even for marketing, for communication, for connecting with your audience, then people they'll stay maybe for a moment or two more because you have somebody of influence or you have somebody co-signing it, but they won't actually buy into it and they won't actually live in the space that you're creating within that story, because when we tell stories, we're creating a space, we're creating that sort of environment, and we're asking people to come into that place and live with us and experience that story with us. They won't believe it because it's not coming from an authentic place. And we're just using elements that we think that the audience wants instead of actually relying on sound storytelling techniques. It's not about selling. Many people think that to have a great story, you have to sell people on an idea, sell people on a whole bunch of things. It really isn't about selling. It's about telling people like who are you? Why is that important? Why do you do what you do? Why is this an initiative, to have Black leadership within the Dufferin County? Why is that important? Why is it important to have, ask a professional? What does that do for our community? What does that do for our young people? Why is that important? That now that opens up dialogue for you to really create the color and paint the picture for the audience and for the viewer and for your target audience to be able to understand better why you do what you do, right? It gives you the space and the room and the opportunity not to just say support us, but now to say, this is why we do what we do, and this is the benefits, and this is how this is the world that we're trying to create, and a community that we're trying to build and develop. Now, does that seem like something that fits into, what you see? And 9 times out of 10, people be like, "Yo, I want to be a part of that. That's amazing, right?" It's not about being cool. Many people want to have that cool factor, have everything looking slick, having the branding, having the sound effects, having the music, and that's great. That is good. That's a tool, but that's not digital storytelling. That's the icing, not the cake. It's not supposed to be agreeable. And this is something that I had to learn the hard way. When you tell stories, every story is not supposed to be something that aligns and that makes sense for everybody, right? Not if you have people that don't get it and that don't like it, that's okay too. It's okay to have, perspectives from the opposite direction coming and critiquing and maybe saying this is what they don't like or this is what they do like or this is what they agree with and this is what they don't agree with. When you're creating and telling a story, even if it's your own personal story, it's your perspective. And not everybody has your perspective. Matter of fact, nobody has your perspective because nobody's gone through life the way you have. So if you have some people that do agree, that's a miracle in and of itself. But kind of create an approach, creating and telling stories from the vantage point of just telling it and telling it from a true place and an authentic place. And regardless of whether or not people are going to agree with it or not, it's coming from your perspective, right? Here's something that's really, really true. Create what you see. I don't need to see whether it's on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, you know, whatever platform, social media platform, TikTok, YouTube. I don't need to see what the next person is creating on your channel or on your page or on your feed. I want to see how you see the world. I want to hear from you, whether it's, you know, a bio or a blog or whatever it is. I want to hear and see what you have to say and see it from your perspective, because that's the value that you're bringing to the community. These are just some examples of different ways that you can tell stories, and then we'll go into a Q&A.
I remember him. I remember when he came out the womb, Matthias, for the first time, and he came out. It's almost like his hands popped up in the air, and his palms were wide open.
To be honest with you, when my daughters were first born, I can't even tell you. It was like a blur.
I was selfish. Most of what I did when I was younger was all about me.
Well, at that time, not having a dad in my life, I really didn't pay special attention to that, because my auntie was like my dad and mom at the same time.
So just to kind of give you an example, or just to kind of explain the two different things. So the one before was TikTok. And I know, like, as an adult, you're kind of like, well, like, what are they doing? Why are we watching TikTok? But I think from a short form standpoint or format, it's really valuable to watch sort of TikTok or Instagram reels and things of that nature, because number one, that's one of the best ways to get engagement, especially for your feed and for your social media activities, is by creating short form stories. But number two, I found those stories to be interesting just because, again, one was just kind of like a random, like, this is what I used to do as a kid, random things I used to do as a kid. But I found myself watching that video because I was like, what is he doing next? And I actually related to a lot of the things that he was doing, the random things he was doing, because I kind of did that as a kid, or I saw other friends doing that as a kid. Then the next one was literally just a guy opening up balloons. And it was like, okay, well, what's the point of that? There really wasn't any point to the balloons and the actual content. But the thing that I want to home in on was this idea of like, although we knew it was just balloons, we also want to see, well, what was inside the next balloon, right? Even whether or not it was like, it was satisfying at the end. It was like, well, what's next? Okay, there's ice, and then there's another color, and another color. Oh, what's the ending? And that's another part of storytelling. And again, you can make things that are super, super on the nose and something that's super intentional and has a deep meaning to it. And then you can make stuff that is random as well, but I think we can learn from all techniques because we can integrate things. It's just like cooking, right? Like we cook with different spices for different reasons, right? And then this one is more of a traditional style of a letter from the fathers, which actually, so two of the people, men in there are actually related to me. So one looks like me, like a skinnier version of me, that's my brother. And then the bald headed gentleman who's at the end, the Jamaican, well, three of them were bald headed. But the one with the glasses, I believe that was bald headed, he's my father. So anyways, that being said, I'm going to wrap it here. I want to answer some questions that you may have. I'm super excited to hear from you. Let me know if anything makes sense or things didn't make sense, and we'll go from there.
Awesome. Okay. And we do have a question from Steve Anderson, Deputy Mayor.
Oh, man. First of all, Tristan, thanks for doing this. And thanks for the shameless plug about the book. I appreciate that. And before I release it, I'll certainly have you do the story. This brother is underselling himself. And I would encourage everybody to actually go to his website. It's not just pick up some equipment and just go tell your story. All storytelling is not made equal. This brother is the creme de la creme. And again, don't take it from me. Go to his website, look at his YouTube videos, and you'll see the jewel that we have here in Shelburne and in Dufferin County. This guy is the real deal. My question though for you, Tristan, is how do you get people to flush out that story? Because oftentimes you come to people, they're very headstrong in their story. They think they have it sort of all made out. How do you sort of maybe infiltrate that and get them to realize that maybe there's much more to the story to really make it optimal?
No, that's a great question. I think one of the biggest things that I try to do first is I try and listen, because oftentimes by the time people get to me, they have an idea, or they have a lot of different ideas and big ideas, but they don't really have a firm and clear outline and concept. And they're coming to me and they're kind of like doing a mental dump of all these ideas. And one of the things that I try to do is I try to listen first. And then what I love to do is to reverse engineer. And what I mean by reverse engineering, I want to know what they want the outcome to be. Okay, I want to make a 3.5 minute brand film, or I want to make a product video, or I want to make a documentary about living in rural Canada or rural Ontario. Okay, cool. That's the end result. What do we want to do? How do we get to there? So we got to reverse engineer it and say, okay, well, these are some of the elements that we need, right? What do you want the audience to feel, think, and walk away with, right? Right. Those are some things that we need to know or have a good understanding of. When we get to that, then we can say, okay, cool. This is like, you know, not even just our shoot schedule. These are some of the elements that we need to include. We need to include, you know, interviewing some of these people, or we need to maybe include some of these elements of your story. Maybe not so much that element, because that's not necessarily going to add value. That's just adding more fluff or maybe more icing to a cake that's already been made. Right. So it's really just kind of guiding them and allowing them to ultimately make some of the harder decisions. But I'm always there as an advisor to be like, okay, trust my judgment, but then I'm also going to give your voice space to speak, because it is your story, right? I'm not going to just tell your story without your input, but I'm going to also allow you to understand, you know, when I push back, the reason I'm pushing back is because I want to honor what we agreed upon from the get-go, which was this is the outcome. So if an apple is an outcome, we can't be planting orange seeds and you know, pear seeds and putting in all these other ingredients that don't yield the fruit that we want. So I think the first step is always understanding the outcome. Second step is reverse engineering sort of how we get to it in terms of setting up the people that are going to be involved, the shoots, and then what platforms we want to get it to. So that's sort of like Cold Notes edition. I go deeper, but that's sort of the way we work.
Perfect. Great question, Steve. Thank you so much. So I know you talked a lot about, you know, overall what digital storytelling is and is not. And as an individual, so you don't necessarily have a business, but you have your own personal brand to get out there. For me, I know I personally will want to tell the story about, you know, the whole kitchen sink and everything else. So how do we now, you know, go through that deeper dive, much like what you just answered about the reverse engineer, but from a personal branding perspective, how do you do that deep dive to get crisp and concise exactly what it is that you're trying to get to?
That's great. No, that's great. Think of storytelling and content creation as cooking, right? You know, one of the first things we have to do is we have to make a list, right? Do some grocery shopping and get the raw ingredients. Now, those raw ingredients may change in form or in fashion based upon the process of how we prep it, season it, cook it, and then present it, right? But the raw ingredients are the first element, right? So when we're talking about our personal brands, we should have a brain dump. We should write down all of our accomplishments, all of our failures, all of the challenging points, our feelings, our emotions. But not only that, it's really, really important to gain the perspective of how other people view us, family members, close friends, maybe colleagues, and try and be as non, how can I say it? Non-judgmental or confrontational as possible. Because when people are talking about you and you want them to be honest, you got to be able to give them the space and the room and the permission to be like, well, Tristan, you're a little sketchy here. I feel like your vibe is really great there. You're passionate, but you drop the ball here, or you give me this. Or I remember a time when this happened and this was a real challenge for you. And it may bring up some unwanted feelings or emotions, but I feel like that's good for the process, because what it'll allow you to do is, number one, it'll keep your story human and grounded, because oftentimes we sometimes have this elevated view of ourselves, sometimes depending on who's writing our story. But then also, I think it also allows us to actually identify themes, right? So you'll see as you start writing down certain big elements that happen in your story, just writing it down as it comes back to your memory, you'll see sort of peaks and valleys, and you'll see specific themes that you can utilize. Remember, going back to one of the original points, utilizing universal themes. So once you have all of those sort of elements down and you've identified some of the universal themes, then what you want to do is you want to kind of distill it down to the most pertinent pieces of information. So, you know, what do you want your brand? Like when people think about, I'll use myself, when people think about Tristan Barrocks, right? What do I want people to think, feel, and say, right? What's the vocabulary of the Tristan Barrocks brand? What's the feeling? You know, when people think about me, do they think about, you know, the air horn, or do they think about reggae music, or do they think about, you know, neo soul, or do they think about progressive thought processes? Do they think about high-end, high-level storytelling? What do they say when I'm not around? Do they say, you know what, Tristan's cool, but he's not worth the money? Or, you know, Tristan is an amazing resource, I can't believe that he hasn't had more opportunities. Or, you know, he's elevated my brand from, you know, one place to another place. What are some of those sort of ancillary conversations that when I'm not in the room that people are saying about me? So when you go through all of those sort of thought processes, and it takes time because this is your personal brand. So I don't think that this is just an overnight thing, but it takes a little bit of time to really process some of that information. Then that leads you to the next phase, which is like, again, distilling down like the major themes. So I want to be known as reliable. I want to be known as a progressive thinker, a leader, and a resource within my said profession. I want to be able to be maybe a public speaker and get more public speaking opportunities. Okay, well, how do I position myself as that? Maybe I talk a little bit about when I was young and I was a child and I didn't, you know, I wasn't confident in public speaking and I maybe had a speech impediment. And then I had to work through that. Many people have to work through that. Many people can relate to that. And then when they see where you come and where you are, then all of a sudden they're like, man, like this is a great story. I can relate to that. Maybe, you know, it's, I had a loss in the family. Maybe somebody passed away that was really close to me, that was my guide and my influence. And that propelled me into, you know, going and pursuing my purpose. So so once you kind of identify those big major things and themes, and you understand sort of like how you want people to think, feel, and say about your brand, your personal brand, then that really helps facilitate how you now push out the types of content that you are pushing out, how you tell your story. And then you can work with an individual like myself. If you feel like, okay, I've gotten to a certain point where I'm comfortable, but I still need somebody to maybe create the content or somebody to help me distill it down even more. So it's simple for me to be able to discuss it with others. Does that make sense?
That makes perfect sense. And you touched on my follow-up question. So if someone wanted to tell their story, does TristanBarrocks.com have the full suite of expertise? So can I just go to Tristan and say, hey, Tristan, I need to get my story out there. What are the next steps? Or do you have different people that you need to leverage now to put the pieces together? And we do have some questions from the chat also that I'll take up after.
Yeah, no. So my team and myself, we have a whole suite and litany of stuff. The only thing we focus on, the two major areas that we focus on is storytelling, right? Story over everything is something that we live by. It's a mantra that we live by, meaning that above anything else, above any book, product, service, whatever else, we're leveraging the art and the power and the tool of storytelling. And that's what we focus on. And we use digital platforms to do that. But then number two, we help you with sort of developing a story, but then we also provide those sort of practical services like, you know, being able to tell your story through photography, through cinematography, through graphic design and the like. And then we also have stakeholders and other partners that will provide things like web services and some of the practical platforms that you need to be able to disseminate your story. But we're passionate about really being able to empower people, say, okay, use what you have. And if you feel like you gotten to a point where you cannot use what you have, or you just can't manage it, then now let's come to us and now we'll elevate and upgrade you even more. So that's sort of what we do.
Perfect, thank you. I'm just gonna read out some of the comments and questions from the chat. We have a feedback from Minerva. Great job, Tristan. And a question from Paul Vere. Thank you for sharing such great insight, Tristan. What is your advice readapting one story based on audience, or do you recommend adjusting based on the age, culture, context, etc.?
Okay. Let me look at that again. So, audience. Okay. Yeah. I think that every story. I think every story needs a little tweaking, even just like with, I'll give you an example. This is more of a practical example, but depending on, you know, which audience I'm in front of, I will share my presentation a little bit differently, right? And my presentation is a story in and of itself, right? It's a journey. I'm taking you somewhere where I need you to go. And I think that knowing your audience should be the determining factor of how you tell your story and to what degree you tell your story. I do a lot of Black history presentations. There's certain things I'll touch on with, you know, JKSK to grade threes that will be elevated when I get to middle school or when I get to, you know, the grade six, seven, eights, right? And again, that's a practical example. But I think that the more that you can customize the story to align or to connect better to the audience that you're in front of, the more the actual story will hit and the more effective the story will be. That doesn't mean that you're being disingenuous. What you're doing is you're saying, okay, if Tristan Barrocks is speaking in front of a bunch of mothers, okay, and I'm not a female, I'm not a woman, I never birthed a child, right? But I do understand something about parenting. And I understand something about raising a Black son. And I understand something about you know, educating and teaching and being in relationship with my wife, who is a woman, who is a mother. I can speak about my story, I tell my story from that vantage point. And that vantage point, hopefully, in my opinion, will connect with the audience that I'm in front of that I may not have any sort of other relations with. Now, in other cases, it may be a mixed crowd of West Indians. So then the moment I say, I've already built that level of alignment, right? That one thing there says a few different things. He knows about West Indian culture enough to know that, okay, that's like a dance hall DJ thing. You know, everybody knows about that. He's funny. He's fun. He's a little laid back, not too laid back, but enough for me to let down my hair and maybe ask some questions, maybe bust some jokes. And also now people are perking up and they're thinking, what's next? If he's going to play that, what other sound effect is he going to play that I'm going to know and I'm going to identify with? And that automatically, just with me doing that for 30 seconds, 15 seconds, I've built a level of relatability and a connection with the audience without saying a word, right? So these are things that we can do by leveraging just specific tools that speak to stories, right? That air horn is not just an air horn. It speaks to culture. It speaks to ethnicity. It speaks to fun. It speaks to music. It speaks to, you know, relationships. It speaks to, you know, youthfulness. It speaks to our history and our, and people know that, yo, when that's the turn up button, right? So all of those things are ways that you can customize your audience. You can see I'm very passionate about this because it's super important.
It's good that you're passionate. I love it. We are at 7 minutes away from the close of tonight's show. Gonna turn it over to the audience to see if there are any other questions in the chat. Nope, but I do have some questions that were pre-submitted. And since you touched on tools earlier, I'm gonna ask you, how can we leverage tools like TikTok and YouTube to tell our story? And I'm sure there are a million other tools out there, but yes, these are some of the ones that come to mind.
Yeah, or like my mom said, the TikToks. I mean, you know, TikTok is and YouTube and things of that nature. They are different platforms that you can use in different ways. And I would say this, that you don't have to be a jack of all trades and master of none. You can pick the platform that speaks to, number one, the audience that you're trying to attract. So, I mean, again, if you're a part of a youth organization or if you're trying to attract and appeal to youth and young people, so that's Generation Z and the millennial generation. If you're not on TikTok, then you're not, you're missing the whole show, right? It's a tool. It's a platform that can be used for good and evil. And I think that many, many people are using it in very effective ways to tell their organization's story as well as their own personal story. So many ways you can do it. You can use humor and tell stories about, you know, funny things that are happening to you throughout the day, or, you know, bakers are using it to show recipes within 30 to 60 seconds long. People are using it to have dance offs or to show different ways to incorporate dance moves into their presentations and things of that nature on TikTok. On YouTube, people go to YouTube for information. They're very project driven and question driven. It's YouTube is another search engine. It's an extension of Google. What does that mean? When you're creating content, you should be answering a question. You should be providing a solution. If you're not providing a solution, then YouTube may not be the best platform for you, right? If you're just trying to, if you're creating, let's say, a conversation, you may want to look at a Facebook, because Facebook is like what I call a campfire. It's like people are just around a campfire and having conversations, and whatever conversation comes up and is interesting, that's what's kind of sparking people's sparking people's interest, I should say. But not only that, Facebook is like the mall. Why do people go to the mall? I don't know. They just go to the mall, walk around, and all of a sudden they got, oh, there's something happening at the Bay, or there's Aldo's having a sale, and they walk out with several bags, and they never wanted to walk out with several bags, but they were at the mall, so all of a sudden everything caught their attention. That's what Facebook is. So when you're creating content for Facebook, you want to create content that will catch people's attention, to hold people's attention, and maybe get them to feel like they have to do something. They have to comment, they have to follow, like, share, subscribe, things of that nature. So that's how you can leverage some of those platforms.
Perfect. I'm going to invite the audience to submit any comments and feedback on today's event. And I'm also going to put out a poll for everyone to comment on today's event as well. And just let me know how you're feeling in terms of the content and relevancy and the new knowledge that you've gained. And before we close, I'm just gonna quickly share our next event. The next Ask the Expert series event takes place on May 4th, and it is one that you definitely do not want to miss again. We have two very special guests who will be coming on to talk about vaccine competency or vaccine hesitancy, depends on the spectrum that you're on. So we have Amy Varley and Sarah Fong, both registered nurses, and both have been doing great work in the community. Again, no strangers to Dufferin County, doing some great work in the community. You may have seen them on the various news outlets, whether it's CTV, W5, the list goes on and on. So please make sure that you look out for that invitation and sign up. One final housekeeping item. You may have noticed that there was a membership draw that was taking place for the month of March. I'm very excited to share that the winner has been selected, and she will be notified shortly that she won. But I have to give a big shout out to our local entrepreneur, Ufi. Ufi is a local clothing company, a young teenager entrepreneur right here in Dufferin County who established a clothing line, and he generously donated the prize for the month of March for the membership contest. So big shout out to Ufi, Tyrell Harris, thank you very much. And I'm gonna hit start on the poll and I'm gonna invite Tristan to talk a little bit more on how our audience can get a hold of him and how to reach him, et cetera, and all of that good stuff.
Yeah, absolutely, thank you so much. And before I even jump into that, I just wanna say thank you so much for having me. I really do appreciate it. You know, to the DCCBA, I really love what you guys are doing, and any way I can support and help, I'm definitely down for that. And I think that this is a great cause and a great organization that we all need to support, and we all need to make sure that we volunteer and we're able to support them in any way that they need. That being said, if you want to get a hold of me, you can get a hold of me through a few different ways. You can go on my website, tristanbarrocks.com. That has information about content, whether it's content creation, or if you need me to come and speak and contribute to one of your events, your next events, I'm available for that, as well as mentorship and doing creating more of a digital community in terms of educating people about storytelling. So that's all there on my website. You can also follow me on social media, which is all my social media is the same. I'm going to put it inside the chat. It's at Tristan Barrocks, and all my social media is under that handle: Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, Facebook, TikTok. Everything is under that tag. I have a lot of great content under my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/ Tristan Barrocks. And that's a channel, we have over 4,000 subscribers. Definitely would invite you to be a part of the community. Every week I'm doing live streams, answering questions just like this, just like today, as well as sharing a boatload of information through videos and different visual mediums.
Perfect. And Gabrielle joining us from the USA. Wow. Awesome. Well, thank you for joining us.
That's dope.
Where in the US are you from, Gabrielle?
I'm from Indiana, actually.
Oh. Okay, awesome. And welcome.
Awesome.
I just wanted to say thank you very much for all of this. As both someone going into freelancing for graphic design and costume design, that really helps with bring out my brand more. And originally it was for just an event, a networking event essay for a class, but this has helped very much.
Oh, amazing, amazing, amazing.
Wonderful, thank you. And I'm happy that you were able to join us. Okay, so we are at time. Thank you for joining us, everyone. I am going to, if you haven't had a chance to complete the poll, I will leave it up for another 30 seconds. And look out for our YouTube channel, Dufferin County Canadian Black Association. The first three episodes have been loaded, and I will also put this on our social media pages for you to follow the link. Of course, you can go to our website, www.dufferincountycba.org, and click on the YouTube link there as well. Tonight's episode will be loaded. And as I mentioned before, the previous three episodes have been loaded, so feel free to browse. Yeah. So thank you everyone for coming out. It's 8:03. I'm gonna officially close our session. And stay tuned. Make sure you sign up and register for our next event on May 4th on vaccine competency. So have a great night, everyone. Amazing session, Tristan. Awesome. Thank you so much. Well done.
My pleasure.